MotorWeek is made possible by TireRack.com and State Farm.
This time on MotorWeek 91, a whole show dedicated to Porsche. We'll drive the new 911 Turbo. We'll look at Porsche's past, present, and at their future. And find time for fun on the Autobahn. So come drive with us next.
MotorWeek 91, television's automotive magazine, is made possible by the financial support of public television viewers like you. Your host for MotorWeek 91, John Davis.
Well, hello and welcome again to MotorWeek 91. We're glad to have you with us. Usually on MotorWeek, we talk about and show you a number of different makes and models. But this week, we're going to concentrate on the models of one car maker, Porsche. The sports cars from Stuttgart have captivated many Americans. More than half of all the Porsches rolling are in the U.S. Why the popularity? And what makes a Porsche different from any other sports car? To answer those questions, we'll have to do some traveling. We'll take you to Stuttgart to meet Porsche's new chairman and see the factory where the cars are built. Then come along as we find out what it's like to drive a Porsche in its home country. But we begin with a trip not to Germany, but to France, where Porsche has just introduced its latest model, the new 911 Turbo. The original 911 Turbo, launched in 1974, breathed new power into the rear-engine Porsche. Changing little over the years, it sold 20,640 units worldwide, a high number for such a specialized car. Alas, the Turbo was discontinued in 1989. Porsche knew that life without the Turbo would be dreary for some Porsche loyalist. Enter the new 911 Turbo. While changes seem subtle, more than 85% of the car is new. MotorWeek, along with other members of the automotive press, spent several days driving the Turbo at the car's introduction in the south of France. The first thing you notice about the new Turbo is its bodywork. Like the Carrera 2 and 4, this Porsche's shape has been softened and rounded, but the flared fenders have a more pronounced edge. Though you can't see it, the car is smoother underneath than the old one, and the aerodynamics were tailored to keep the Turbo from lifting at speed. Its drag coefficient is 0.36, compared to 0.39 for the old Turbo. The Carrera actually cuts a cleaner hole through the air, with a drag coefficient of 0.33. The rear spoiler creates a lot of drag, but it needs to be here. Where else was Porsche going to mount the new Turbo's larger intercooler? The new engine cranks out 315 horsepower in U.S. trim. That's 33 more horses than before. It's a 3.3-liter, just like the 89 turbo engine. We had speculated the turbo engine would be based on the 3.6-liter from the Carrera, but Porsche decided to just modify the previous turbo engine instead. The intake and exhaust systems are both new, and so is the engine's turbocharger and electronic brain. Aside from the engine, the turbo shares a lot of its new parts with the Carrera 2 and 4. It has given up its old torsion bar suspension in favor of the Carrera's front strut rear coil spring setup. It also has power steering for the first time, which makes the turbo a lot easier to park. ABS brakes are here, as expected, but they're larger than those on the Carreras. Inside, again, the turbo shares a lot with its less powerful siblings. Any 911 owner will feel at home here. The seats are power operated, but don't really provide enough support to hold you upright in hard corners. American specification cars get airbags for both the driver and passenger. The gauges are traditional 911. Some of the readouts are blocked. The only real change here is the addition of a turbo boost gauge. A Porsche Symphony stereo is new, but we never really got a chance to listen to it, because there are better things to do with the 911 Turbo, like finding out if all the hardware really performs as advertised. We didn't have a chance to run the 911 on a closed track, but we estimate a 0 to 60 time of just under 5 seconds and a quarter mile time of just under 13. That puts the turbo in the ballpark with the Ferrari Testarossa, Corvette ZR1, and Callaway Corvette. Until we get a 911 turbo on our home turf, we won't know for sure just how quick it is. As for top speed, Porsche estimates 168 miles per hour. And acceleration is, well, turbo-like. Though smoother than before, power comes up high in the revs. With your foot to the floor in third gear, the turbo gives an experience you can have in no other car. The brakes we talked about will pull the turbo down from 60 even faster than the car can accelerate to 60. The task takes 2.7 seconds, 111 feet on average. As for handling, with the new suspension comes a measure of predictability that the turbo has never had before. Though the back end, which carries 62% of the Porsche's weight, will come around, it needs more provocation to do so now. At very high speed, the turbo is solid and easily holds a straight course, but we found the car disagreeable when presented with a strong crosswind. Our only other complaint is noise, something that comes with an air-cooled engine, and something Porsche fans are used to. We didn't spend all our time driving fast. In town, the turbo behaves like a Carrera 2. Its exhaust note and demeanor give no hint that you're driving a car with so much power. And while the rear end is wider than that of the Carrera and the spoiler higher, rearward visibility is still better than in most exotic cars. And if you're comparing the turbo to other European exotics, the price is cheaper, $95,000. If you're comparing to other Porsches, the turbo, at $30,000 more than a well-outfitted Carrera 2, may not be a bargain. Either way, it's the most civilized, ultra-high-performance car on the market, and the most breathtaking Porsche you can buy. If you're guessing that the first Porsche model was the 356, you're right. But Porsche designs have been around for much longer. To tell the whole Porsche story, we have to begin at the turn of the century. The first Porsche automobile. Built in Austria by the Jacob Lohner Company in 1900, it was designed by Ferdinand Porsche. Porsche was first interested in electricity. At an early age, he fitted his parents' house with electric lights. And his Lohner Porsches, as well as some other Porsche designs, were powered by electric wheel hub motors. After a time with the Austrian firm Austro Daimler, where he designed these Sascha racing cars, Porsche moved on to Daimler and Stuttgart Unter Turkheim. He began a memorable period in design for Mercedes cars. It was Porsche who gave us the S, SS, and SSK models. And again, he was able to prove and improve his designs through racing. Porsche later set up his own design and engineering office in Stuttgart, where he worked for many companies. Ferdinand Porsche's son took a position in the new firm. Also named Ferdinand, but known as Ferry, it was the younger Porsche who had great enthusiasm for the idea of a small car for the masses. The Porsche design office worked on a number of concepts for a people's car. This one, designed by Porsche for NSU, looks very much like the later Volkswagen. And when Adolf Hitler in 1934 made the need for a people's car a matter of public policy, the contract for its design and construction was given to Porsche. Porsche had only 10 months and a small amount of money to complete the car. The established automakers in Germany predicted Porsche's failure, but the prototype came out on time and passed its test. A factory was even built. But the Volkswagen, also known as the KDF car, was delayed by the war. In those years, another famous Porsche design emerged, the Auto Union race car. With its engine placed at the rear instead of in the front, it was the forerunner of all modern formula racing machines. There was another great silver machine designed by Porsche in that era, the T80. Built for Daimler-Benz to capture the land speed record, it boasted 3,000 horsepower from a modified Daimler-Benz aircraft engine. The original plan was for the car to run at the Bonneville Salt Flats, but war put an end to any record attempt. In the late 30s, Porsche was ordered by the German government to design military equipment. The famous Kubelwagen and the Schwimmwagen, both based on the Volkswagen, were just two of the results. Porsche was also responsible for developing the Tiger, Leopard, and Mouse tanks. Because of his involvement in the war effort, Ferdinand Porsche was imprisoned by the French. Son Ferry Porsche was luckier and set off to design a Porsche that would finally wear the family name. The car was the 356. Like the Auto Union cars and the Volkswagen, it had its engine at the rear. Based in the beginning on Volkswagen parts, it evolved over the years, gaining power, racing victories, and admirers. Sadly, Ferdinand Porsche did not live to see much of the car's success. He died not long after his release from prison. But a third Porsche came on the scene, Ferdinand Alexander Porsche, Ferry Porsche's son. Known as Bootsy, he was responsible for styling the Porsche 911. In the 60s, Porsche became a growing force in the world of auto racing and produced a number of formula and sports cars, most famous of all, the Le Mans-winning Porsche 917. While the company's products became more familiar, Porsche's original design consultancy continued and expanded with the opening of WEISAG, the research and development facility not far from Stuttgart. Porsche, today a publicly held company, is true to its roots. Engineering is a top priority, and the company is guided by family. Bootsy Porsche, though running his own design firm now, was recently appointed head of the Porsche Supervisory Board. And Ferry Porsche, at age 81, still arrives for work daily at 9 a.m. As we've seen so far, Porsche has almost always been involved in racing. The racetracks of the world have been sort of a second proving ground for the company's products. Porsche's high-speed research and development program has also given us some of the most spectacular race cars of all time and a lot of talented racing drivers. At an intersection on the high road, Craig Singhaas has arranged a reunion of just such a Porsche and just such a driver.
In the history of Porsche racing, there's probably no car as revered or respected as the model known as the 917.
The 917 was a juggernaut, released from Stuttgart in the spring of 1969. It came to dominate international endurance racing in the early 1970s and is considered by many to be the greatest racing Porsche of all times. This particular 917 was brought to us by Dale Miller of the Collier Automotive Museum and was to be driven by none other than Porsche racing legend Vic Elford. For Elford, this meeting marked the 20th anniversary of his 1971 Sebring win driving a 917.
What was it like to drive a 917? Yeah, it was a very challenging car. In fact, I was one of only two drivers, I think, to start with, who really fell in love with the 917 before we ever drove it. And, you know, it was the first time the engineers had been able to put that sort of power into any sports racing car.
With its 12-cylinder engine, ranging in displacement from 4.5 to 5 liters, the 917 could produce over 600 horsepower in normally aspirated form.
Aerodynamics was very much in its infancy, especially at those speeds, because up until then, I believe the fastest cars ever at Le Mans had been doing about 185, maybe 190 miles an hour. And we suddenly jumped up to 220, 225. Such was the measure of Porsche engineers. Just 1 year later with the long tail 917, we were doing very nearly 250 miles an hour on the straight. It was quite a challenge, the very first ones, mainly because they were very unstable at high speed. One of the things about the car, it used to wander. It used to need a lot of room, even just driving down a straight road. And it very, very quickly earned a reputation as being a bit of a monster amongst all the other drivers. And that had the advantage of the fact that when we did come onto the straight, everybody, but just everybody, queued up on the right-hand side until we'd gone by.
And go by they did. 917s came to win the Fédération Internationale d'Automobile Group 4 Championship in 1970 and 71. Then banned from Group 4 racing, 917 Roadsters blew away the competition in FIA's Can-Am series. And again, being unbeatable, they were simply outlawed.
And I suppose if I had to pick out, of all the cars I've driven, and that's quite a lot, one single car that was my favorite car to race, it would be the 917.
The 917 is the quintessential Porsche race car. But if you ask any enthusiast to name their fantasy road-going Porsche, the response will likely be 959. Even though only a handful were built, the 959 has captured the imagination of millions. The car has also generated more words than any other car in recent memory. To say any more would be redundant. We won't. But we do invite you to take a vicarious ride through us.
The sweetest perfection to call my own, the slightest correction couldn't find me home. The sweetest infection of body and mind, sweetest injection of any kind.
Since the introduction of the 959 in 1986, a lot has changed at Porsche. Lisa Barrow's here with me now to tell us all more.
Well, recently, John, Porsche hired a new chairman, Arno Bone. A change in management can have a big impact on any company, so we sent our cameras to Stuttgart to find out what direction Bone has in mind for Porsche.
I think the direction is very clear for all of us. It's simply sports cars.
But things were not so clear for Porsche just a few years ago, when sales dropped dramatically in the U.S. market and the company fell on hard times.
A dollar spent in 1985 from an American converted into 3 marks at that time here. Now it only converts into 1.50 mark, but we still have the same costs, basically, and even higher maybe. So we had to invest in dramatically in new technologies in production everywhere to get our costs down and to stay competitive, which we achieved now.
These days, Porsche is not nearly as dependent on the U.S. market, but Porsche has still another way to protect itself against the fluctuations in currency exchange rates. The company's second business, the famous Weissach Research and Development Center, is busier than ever.
Every fourth of our employee is an engineer. And they develop not only for Porsche, but for many other companies. So we have the development foundation on the one side and the car foundation on the other side.
But Porsche has had another problem, competition. Many Japanese manufacturers have built successful challengers for the Porsche 944. And now those companies are moving in on the higher end of Porsche's market.
I'm happy, yeah, to have new competitors because that really opens the market and it makes the segment bigger.
And what about Acura's new NSX, a challenger for the 911?
Oh, it's a very nice car. I would not particularly like the interior. I think it has a very good engine, high elasticity. Suspension is nice, brakes are good. I did not really understand the design of the body. is this a design which will last for many, many years? Or is the next Honda a completely different design, and then you will forget the old one? So has it a character? Other than that, it has very nice technical features, certainly. And so our next one will be better.
And what of Porsche's next one? And how about that rumored sedan?
And we think Porsche for more than two is a good idea. It doesn't mean necessarily four doors, but more than two people.
And will Porsche turn to a V12 and compete with BMW and Mercedes-Benz?
This is not our way of thinking. I think that a reasonable number of cylinders, so to speak, it's six or eight or even four, is the solution for the future.
We can't be sure of Porsche's product plans, but we do know this.
So the design of Porsche is forget the unnecessary. I think that is a basic thinking of our company.
Since our MotorWeek crew was already in Germany to meet with Arno Bohn and tour the Porsche factory, they decided it would be fun to take in some of the sights. And what better way to explore Germany than in a Porsche? Professor Porsche chose this city as the home for Porsche cars partly because of its location. All roads seem to lead here. And we found Stuttgart a convenient starting point for our tour of southern Germany. Despite its industrial look and purpose, Stuttgart has its share of postcard images. But we had come to see automotive images. There are plenty at the Porsche Museum. Located next to the Porsche factory in Zuffenhausen, it's a walk through Porsche history. You'll find everything here from Ferry Porsche's first 356 to Teo Fabi's Indy race car. Sadly, Porsche doesn't have enough space to display all of the cars in the collection. But Mercedes-Benz has no such problem in their museum. Just minutes from the center of Stuttgart in Untertürkheim, the Mercedes-Benz Museum was renovated for the 100th anniversary of the automobile. The building is large and bright. The cars themselves are elevated somewhat, but are not so far away as to feel inaccessible. In this atmosphere, they seem eager to be fired into life. Our time in Germany was short, and there were other places we wanted to see. We picked up our European specification Porsche 928 GT and made our way to the Autobahn. The A81 takes you north out of Stuttgart. From there, we found our way to the Rhine and followed it northwest past the town of Koblenz and on to nearby Nürburgring, home of the Nürburgring Castle and the famous Nürburgring Grand Prix Racing Circuit. For 13 marks, you can live out your wildest automotive fantasy on the world's most demanding road course. You don't have to be Fangio to drive here. The track is open to anyone, which is good and bad. The locals are a bit impatient with newcomers who don't know the right way around. Our next stop was Munich and the Deutsches Museum, a museum of transportation and industry. Here we saw the KDF model that Ferdinand Porsche presented to Adolf Hitler. It was to become the Volkswagen Beetle. And there are more Messerschmitts here than we've ever seen in one place. And the aircraft that was built from the wreckage of von Richthofen's Fokker triplane. We only wish the museum directors weren't so intent on slicing these machines open to show us what's inside. We'll take our aircraft whole, not cut up, thank you. You can't go to Munich without traveling a little farther south to visit Garmisch and Partenkirchen. These two alpine towns are full of lederhosen-wearing men, bell-wearing cows, and the other good things for which Bavaria is known. We heard that Oktoberfest isn't Oktoberfest unless it's celebrated in Munich. This news hasn't made it to Ludwigstrasse in Partenkirchen, where the beer is cold, the sausages are hot, and the walk back to the hotel is short. You can't have an alpine village without an Alp. Garmisch and Partenkirchen have Zugspitz, the tallest Alp in Germany. We left Parkenkirchen to three more weekends of celebration and ventured to the other side of the Black Forest, crossing the border and driving a few kilometers into France. There we visited the town of Mulhouse, home of the Musée National de l'Automobile, formerly known as the Schlump Collection. The largest collection of Bugattis in the world, it's also home to 102 different makes, from the mightiest Mercedes to the most trivial Trabant. We saw a lot of these little East German cars scurrying along the Autobahn. And even drivers from what was East Germany know enough to keep to the right and let you pass. Maybe it's because of these roadside reminders. Most drivers here pay attention to what they're doing, use their signals, and watch their mirrors for faster moving traffic. Speed is still unlimited on much of the Autobahn, and we managed 160 miles per hour in the 928 GT on one lightly traveled Autobahn section. With privilege comes responsibility. Passing on the right is verboten, and a driver must be prepared to use the brakes and use them well. We saw instances when drivers didn't. Rear-end collisions seem to be the most common type of accident here. And fuel is expensive. It cost us $65 every time we filled the Porsche's tank. Even so, we'll go back again to Germany, a theme park for the car enthusiast. It's not hard to understand why Porsche cars have capable brakes, engines, and suspensions, what with a country full of high-speed roads. There are many things that you can say about Porsches, but there's one thing that stands out. Porsches are meant to be driven. They are cars you don't have to pamper or store in a heated garage, cars that don't compromise on things like rearward visibility just for the sake of styling. It's tough to think of any expensive car as practical, but Porsche, like no other exotic, appeals to the practical side of us while still delivering extremely high performance. This is the Porsche appeal. Join us next week when we'll be back with our regular MotorWeek fare. I'm John Davis. We'll see you then.
MotorWeek 91 is made possible by the financial support of public television viewers like you. If you'd like a transcript of this program, send $4 to MotorWeek Transcripts, Owings Mills, Maryland 21117. Residents of Maryland at 20 cents sales tax. Ask for show number 1018. MotorWeek is a production of Maryland Public Television.